Has SK scrimmed and played so much with Forgiven that they know exactly how to shut him down?
I think that's a great question when you consider how well Fnatic turned around their mid-game against Elements and just how well Reckless performed after joining Fnatic. We'll find out shortly. As Gambit are on the blue side, they've taken away LeBlanc from Fox and Maokai from Freddy. Ryze has gone off. We know junglers are still available here. Gragas is up, Rek'Sai is up. But for Forgiven, which AD carry is he going to play? Five different champions, five different games. Played Corki, played Sivir, played Ashe.
Are we ready for the Graves?
Is Graves next? Is it a, you know...
Draven?
Roll a champion roulette dial and find one that'll help pick up a win, or is it strategy?
The Russian roulette. Almost, because it hasn't really been working too much. And he's playing with a lot of Russians, get it?
I got it. Thanks for explaining it, though.
Oh, you're welcome. All right, let's get into this game. But yeah, you said it. LeBlanc, Maokai came out. Pretty stable bans against SK Gaming. Ryze is out of the equation, rather. Alistar's still up. Really solid support pick. Seen both these supports play it.
As is Gragas. If Gambit first pick it, you don't know if it's jungle or top.
Yeah, Gambit might try and do that strategy again, where they take both junglers. But I almost feel like it's better on second rotation for them. Just lock in something priority here. And then force SK to at least take one of the junglers themselves. I guess which they'll be happily do so. But there's no point in picking one, because any coach worth their salt will have known that Gambit will likely, you know, take away the next one then in the next rotation. So you sacrifice your first pick just to trade a tier one jungler.
Well, we'll find out what they decide on. I've already mentioned the Alistar's up and available, as is Echo, which we have seen in every single game, banned or picked. Actually has been picked very early on in most cases.
Rek'Sai coming out, so SK Gaming almost has to react with a Gragas here. But what is next? Alistar, as we said earlier. So, draft going well for SK, I feel. If you're not forced into a position where you have to give it more than you can claim, at least double first rotation, then you're happy. You can build pretty much any composition with this, you know. You can look at the likes of Sivir for your AD carry. You have Peel if you want to go crazy and run Vayne. You have All-In if you want to get Kalista. Anything works.
We have to touch on the fact Candy Panda's Vayne yesterday dealt less damage than Freddy's Mundo. Let's be very fair and give some credit to Kasing and Ryu for jumping onto either Fox or Candy.
Yeah, Ryu was fantastic that game. Fight.
So you can't put all the blame on Candy Panda's shoulders, but you do have to highlight the fact that the carry of SK was unable to carry. Let's see if they can fix their problems. Gambit, 30 seconds left. We've seen the junglers, we've seen the support. Nothing has been revealed by either team yet.
I mean, Spring Split Forgiven would have installed Lucian here. No hesitation. Yesterday he went for the Corki. More of a poke-centric build. Seems to want to repeat that. Open up the map for Diamond Pox to assist Cabal Shard. Back to the old Gambit. You can't have the jungler play around two carries and protect them and leverage that. And then the Lugu, which is a flex pick for Gambit Gaming. Reds, you can play at mid. There's no LeBlanc to deny, though.
Well, not this time around. So I think Gambit have done the flex picks a little more than most teams in the last couple weeks. To better or worse, you can argue, but we'll need to see where they put this Lulu.
And historically, they have two. I think they were one of the first teams to draft that early Morgana and then swap it top lane for Cabal Shard. So flex picks to their advantage, sometimes to disadvantage. With that crazy, let's not play Gragas jungle, but Volibear instead. Still a possibility. Rek'Sai has been played in the top lane over in China. We might
flex
see that
picks all around.
We're getting Russian bear here, but I doubt it.
Getting excited, but a lot of
Chibana.
Time to go. Instead, we will see Freddy, I believe, going back to another old school champion. It's just comfort picks, right? Mundo yesterday, Shyvana today. Freddy has to dig very deep in the current meta.
He's just going back in time, you know. When were we doing well? Oh, we were at Worlds, weren't we? Yeah, I played a lot of Shyvana, played a lot of Mundo. Oh, let's just play those champions again. SK said it, we want to go back to the SK of old. Back to Candy Panda. He picked up Kalista here. Kalista Alistar is a very strong combo. So much CC. Again, if you do Fate's Call and you throw in the Alistar, he will no longer get... He won't get bounced backwards like we saw earlier in the game with the Morgana. He'll land straight on top of his enemy, knock him up. Pulverize, headbutt backwards, gives enough time for Kalista to do a whole lot of damage.
And Candy Panda's Kalista's pretty decent as well. KDA is not too much to write home about a 3, however, we'll touch on that in a second. 80% kill participation for Kalista. Gosu Pepper is also going back in time, and he's going with the Manly support.
Fabulous. Yeah, I'm just going to let that breathe for a moment.
So, Taric, roaming Gosu Pepper, let's expect that. You've got wave clear from Corki, from Lulu. We know that'll be mid lane now. Cabochard's got his Hecarim top.
Are we actually seeing a Taric here? I don't know.
It's locked in. It's locked in. As a former support player in the current patch, 5.10, what do you think of Taric?
Now, I'll open this statement with that I haven't played enough Soul Queue as of late to really judge the worth of the mighty Gem Warrior. He might shatter my dreams like he shatters his enemies, but I don't know, man. I guess it's targeted lockdown for Kalista, so she can hop around all she wants. Eventually, she'll get stunned. And then the Foster's Bomb will land and the Rockets will poke and... What the?
Well, then hopefully a Pony will trample all over SK's dreams. Gambit 1-4, as we said. SK 0-5. They round out the composition with a scaling Vladimir. I really feel like this is all mid to late game on the side of SK. And for Gambit, I think they can pull the trigger a whole lot earlier. We'll see whether or not they can aim their Taric Corki combination in the right direction.
You say they can aim it earlier? I feel they almost have to close out the game earlier because the scaling on SK Gaming is absolutely insane. In terms of both soul laners, Vladimir in the mid lane for Fox. Comes quite a monster late game. Shyvana too. Kalista's early game though. If she gets snowballing, yes, then she has mid to late game, but she needs to get a couple of kills. And Taric. I was waiting for the possible mid lane Taric and Lulu support. But Gambit didn't get me this time. And yeah, I'm just gonna keep my eyes on Gosu Pepper and watch out how fabulous he really is, Trevor.
Well, we'll see. If either Gambit or SK have to keep digging back in time, we might get the Muse Sona skin for Gosu Pepper for
flashbacks.
Yes, for those historians that have seen that Photoshop, I strongly suggest you look it up. Guys, there's these team comps. We'll be flashing on your screen at LOL Esports. Will Gambit be picking up their second win, or will SK be grabbing their first of the summer split? Hashtag GMB win, hashtag SK win.
Truly, truly.
Thank you for the signs in the audience. Just caught a glimpse of those. Gambit versus SK with the Gem Knight.
All right.
For the first time in summer.
A real proper Gem Knight. Would have ran Ignite. Go on the offense, and the crowd is supporting Gambit. They love themselves some gems. For they are truly outrageous.
I'm not sure he's picked the right skin, though. And we'll see how quickly Gosu can find his way in.
We have to invade. There's no other way.
Why
the Gem Knight?
You are the Gem Knight.
If there's any flag bearer you want to follow into the fray, it is that fantastic Gosu Pepper.
And he's already put a point into Shatter. W of Taric. Keep your eyes on that. Advantage Gambit. They've got a
one ward. CS lead.
Two CS
lead.
Game changing.
Gambit coming out swinging. They haven't spotted by the ward though.
And it seems to be a mirrored invade on the other side. Take a look at the Kalista stats as we can see the wards being placed down. This is what we're talking about leading into the game. A higher kill participation than the league average for Candy Panda's Kalista.
Now, you touched upon this earlier and you said, hey, is KDA 3.0? Not quite impressive, but going back, I distinctly remember Candy Panda at one point being 5-0-2 on Kalista. Another game being 2-0-1 on Kalista. So he does gets these leads. SK, they don't manage to capitalize on that, or Candy Panda himself doesn't manage to snowball that lead. Will it be a return, or a repetition rather, of that advantage in the early game?
So we'll have to find out. We do see the lanes appear to be standard, or at least they should be. You can see Cabochard, he's gone Ignite teleport, not Smite, in the jungle. And we can also see Freddy starting at the Raptor camp.
So, we've seen the small golem first. Again, nitpick. Back to the Grump though. What you can do with Alistar is you can start headbutt and knock that Grump closer to your lane, finish it, and then act as if you have Pulverize. People will always respect the Pulverize. Just never use them. Never show them that you actually have a headbutt instead. And skill heal, you're still afraid, and then randomly you knock the AD carry away from his Siege Creep and you have a mental advantage. The Art of War. translates into gold, into the Art of Warding. Support, very complex role. You still don't know what you're gonna main support, what you have to do, because you can also play fabulous supports like Taric.
Well, Crepo, Sun Tzu, dropping the knowledge bombs as we do see Ghost Pepper with that Relic Shield. The very first Taric all year between Europe and North America. And we'll see how well this point-and-click stun actually works.
I can see it, because especially playing other melee supports into Alistar usually goes well, because he can't punish you that hard. And then you have some zone on Canny Panda. He can dodge more skill shots, but he can't dodge the stun coming out of from Pepper.
Well, point and click, it definitely makes life easier. Ghostu Pepper zoning away in Rated and Candy Panda. He denied a lot of CS, 16-3. However, you can see that wave building up. So Candy will get the opportunity to kill a few of them as we catch a glimpse of Betsy putting
rain
the
down
hammer
a lot.
Down on Fox.
Fox, you may have sustained, but
ooh,
a lot of damage. Diamond Prox prowling about. Sanguine Pool is ready and pumped to dull.
Well, gonna come over the wall. Fox doesn't actually not get caught by the knockup. Diamond is just gonna slide his way away.
Always so anticlimactic, right?
Well,
goes
not always.
For a tunnel and then a pool.
See, not always. Look at this now. Sven Skjeren is gonna find himself behind Forgiven and Ghost and Pepper. There is a Valkyrie available. See what happens. That's the flash into the pulverize. Headbutts Forgiven backwards. Enrated pushes Forgiven onto the wrong side of the map. Candy Panda tries to follow with a flash, but it does not work out. And Sven Skjeren, he wants to set his sight on the Earth Rider. He's going to find himself on Gosu Pepper. Prey Seeker comes out. Dazzle is stunned, follows up with the Summoner Heal. Now Forgiven is putting those missiles down. Enrated and Sven Skjeren are in trouble.
Yeah.
Enrated goes down. First blood to Forgiven. Gambit with the outplay.
I'm not so sure, Trev. They engage and they put Forgiving in a position where he still has Valkyrie. There is no CC up, and they give him an escape path opposite of the side of Sven Skjeren. Sven Skjeren's trailing all the way in the backwards, and Raiden shuts Forgiving into tower, and he says, okay, well, I'll just, you know, Valkyrie over this wall, and then Candy Panda eats a whole lot of rock as he plants his face into that wall, misses his flash. Poorly executed play by SK Gaming on multiple fronts. Definitely not in sync, and Gambit, they come out ahead. First blood.
Look at the cost here, Crepo. Double the CS advantage for Betsy in the middle lane. More than double the CS advantage for Forgiven in the bottom lane. And first blood.
And no summoners either. And you can use this move once every 5 minutes. That's it, you know, Q flash. And then headbutt backwards. And it doesn't work on a gap close AD carry because he'll just go back and... not sure if I like it. They should have just started fighting and then surprised Sven on the back because they had a ward on the left side and Sven snuck behind that. He had no idea that he was there over the Dragon Pit, and they just gave Gambit the escape route.
So Gambit now have the wave shoving towards their half of the map. Gosu can sit back until he needs to push forward, but Candy continues to be punished with the CS. We did catch a very quick glimpse of Cabochard and Freddy in the top lane. Freddy's back to pick up a Ruby Crystal and Cloth Armor. Cabochard with an early pair of Ninja Tabite. Obviously going to help out against that Shyvana. But I'm looking forward to seeing how those teleport ganks impact the game.
Yeah, and just look at Ghost Pepper right now, what he's doing as we see Diamond Prox going in for a return gank. Hex into knockup, good combo.
Prox gets turned into a Munchkin, he throws down the Ghost. Summoner spell used, however it is trading Ghost for Ignite.
Yeah, secondary Summoner spells traded across the board. But you see Ghost Pepper constantly walking up, pumped with that stun, facilitating the CS for Forgiven against his early, you know, early game Kalista, and he's at 52 CSRI already. And yeah, Svenska's here for a counter gank, but this only works if Forgiven Valkyrie's in. It is Rumble cosplay for Equalizer. Otherwise, when Raid is looking for a Pove on Eddie, but I don't know, Trev.
Appears you don't know a lot today. That's the pass back and forth here.
All right, you tell me then.
Okay.
You know, you're gonna turn around, Mr. Sassy.
Well, we'll see how Gambit continue to play this out. 7 minutes. 2,000 gold advantage and massive CS leads in their mid and AD carry roles. No back from Candy Panda yet, but we do see Forgiven. He's picked himself up a Sheen in the makings of Phage. That's going to be a very, very scary Corki once he gets back into lane.
Faced with roughly 2,000 gold, picks up the Sheen and the components of a Phage. Now his poke will get augmented with an extra buffed up auto attack, and SK will have to play on the defensive. Level 6 though, the Kalistar bot lane can always turn anything around because Unbreakable Will, regardless of how far you're behind, you will not die in that duration if you pop it early. And Kalista, she can get a lot of auto attacks, and that rend is going to be excruciating, so don't get too overzealous just yet. But there's still the exhaust, you know. Pepper's evening it out. While he goes aggressive with the Taric, he always has the exhaust ready for later in the game against the likes of Shyvana diving in. You know, for Vladimir, I like it. I think it's a smart choice overall. Neutralizing the bot lane, getting that Corki to level 6 safely, and then he can farm in any lane. We saw it yesterday. Corki can always range farm.
Something we have to highlight, Fox actually last picked this Vladimir. So he opted into this matchup, into the team composition. He's very far behind for the time being. We've only really seen that Vladimir shining when it's into the likes of Azir, but we do see Gambit, they've started an early dragon with that armor buff from Ghost, Pepper, and Diamond.
However, being 20 CS down after getting two ganks on your lane is nothing unheard of. Yes, he was down a lot of CS early, but he equalized it right now, and he drew Diamond Pox with the early Rek'Sai to mid lane twice. Slowed down the potential dragon for Gambit. I feel like they could have taken this earlier with the lead they had in the mid and bot lane, so Fox definitely not doing too poorly here. Just needs to keep scaling.
Gambit's, they get the dragon faster than their seasonal average thus far. Not by a whole lot, a little bit over a minute. But neither of these teams have had extremely good dragon control. We'll keep talking about that later as Diamond wants to set up for a dive. Teleport coming up.
Main party.
He does have Onslaught of Shadows, and Candy Panda is going to get caught up. He's going to lob in rated forward, and Candy Panda is gone. Gosu continues to tank up as Freddy is teleported in for the fight. Now Cabochard's in retreat. We do see Svenskeren coming to join. Body slams. He knocks Diamond under the tower, and the turret shot will close him out. Exhaust is now on to Freddy as SK continue to look forward. Gosu Pepper split from the rest of his team. Cabo not really swinging around those blades of war. Saves the onslaught away at the end of the fight, and Enraged gets bounced, but he throws down the Unbreakable Will and stays alive. Svenskeren puts the big body back onto Cabo Shot, and Freddy is now running away, but Forgiven will pick up the kill. And it ends up trading back and forth. It's not over yet. As we see Diamond Prox, can he find Sven? No! The Prey Seeker, but I think he spotted him. Tremor Sense means Svenskeren's in trouble. And a tunnel from Diamond should be one extra kill, maybe donated to Betsy.
Betsy walks
so
in.
So unfortunate for Sven.
Thank you very much. Yeah, it's like the T-Rex in Jurassic Park. Just don't move. You're dead if you move. If it hits you, so be it. Just don't ever move. And let's watch this again. So things I want to see here is face call, and I've seen it before. Just doesn't get used optimally. And Raider has two CC abilities that he wants to use. Now he has none. Gets thrown in, and by the time he comes out, Candy Panda is already dead. You can use one headbutt and one pulverize defensively. Yes, it's nitpicking. Ghost of Pepper goes low here, flashes out, and Raider is about to flash in forward. Not quite sure what it achieves, but good knockup or knockback reader from Svenskeren. I like that a lot. Flashes in. I guess he's zoning Forgiven here, and then they turn on Ghost of Pepper, so it's quite all right. Then it gets messy. Cabochard held his ulti all this time. I mean, it barely survives. Good Unbreakable Will here. Catches Forgiven off guard. Good turn from Svenskeren. Double kill for Freddy, but then Forgiven. Just that one extra shot. And he picked up two kills in the fight, and he's snowballing right now. 100 CS at the 11-minute mark. Two kills, one assist. The better end of a bot lane party.
And a tower. A dragon, a tower. Kill advantage, CS advantage. Everything is just going in favor of Gambit as we've crossed over 11 minutes.
And I feel like Forgiven betraying his roots here because he usually hates these type of bot lane parties because he even renamed his summoner name to Let Us 2v3 Please. In addition to, can you please stop ganking my lane over and over again? But as we do talk about that, action in the top lane.
Well, we do see Shyvana trying to get away with that burnout, but the Dragon's Descent is not enough distance. Freddy, the Wyvern, gets run down by Hecarim. While that was going on, we did see Ghost, who actually caught up the bottom lane, so that looks like it was a Fate's Call.
Fate's Call engaged with Svenskeren barreling through. A noble sacrifice from our Gem Lord. Fox is joining here. Mid tower is already down, so Fox has a little bit of time to move because his tier 2 is not under direct threat. However, Betsy moves to top. Let's watch this again. Combo onto Pepper, pulverize, and now you can use Fate's Call, in my opinion, to give extra damage here. And this is good timing here by the Gambit, or by the SK team, rather. Svenskeren comes in, clears up the kill, but you see Candy Panda almost dies in the process. Triforce completed already or Forgiven. This is early. This is a 12-minute Triforce.
Well, if Candy Panda wasn't feeling the pain already, his Vamp Scepter
into Triforce.
Into Triforce is one hell of a big difference. We do see Fox still keeping himself relevant. That CS difference has been closing ever so slightly as Vlad is gaining levels, gaining power. But Betsy's already got himself a Blasting Wand and that Athene, so got some utility, got some AP to play with, and it's going to be even more global gold as it looks like Gambit should secure the second tower, third tower of the game in a moment.
Yeah. And this is big. It seems like we've seen this a lot today. A lot of these teams at the 15-minute mark have these giant gold leads, all doing their best Origin impression, except Origin themselves, ironically. Right now, 5,000 gold lead almost. This point in the game, that's a lot of money.
Wow, I've just heard from production and our stats guys, the last time Taric was played was in 2013 against All Authority versus SK. SK seemed to pull out the fabulous supports apparently. However, there's
desperate times.
More than 2 years apart.
Call for desperate measures. Or fabulous measures, if you may. But it's working.
Look at this, Fox is in trouble, he's sanguined already.
Yes, sustain.
A lot of hurt down, but very defensive early sanguine pull there from Fox.
Yeah, he has to get out, but this is a sustain matchup, a poke matchup. But at least Betsy has the pressure, and that's what it all matters. He can move to those fights on the side lanes quicker than Fox can. Svenskrin's trying to find an opening. Sveti is farming, though, so that's the one saving grace, but it's going to get rough because so much gold advantage. I can't stress this enough. 5,000 gold, 4,000 gold, that's a lot of money.
Three towers and a dragon with another one spawning in 15 seconds. And look at the ring of vision. Gambit have got tunnels, have got wards, have got pink wards. Even the minions are pushing SK back in the bottom half of the map. It looks like the dragon should go Gambit's way because they've got all the ingredients for success.
Now we saw Gambit yesterday get a lead and have some issues closing. The lead wasn't as big at this point in the game as it was yesterday. So now they're farther ahead. Will we see the same, I wouldn't even call it a mistake, but the same hesitation from Gambit?
Yeah, hesitation and definitely trepidation in the way they approached their match yesterday against the Copenhagen Wolves. But for Gambit, this feels different. The decision-making from the players, the vision. I mean, Diamond has really made it very clear where he wants to be playing. You could just see how many tunnels litter the map. If Cabochard's in trouble, tough luck. There's literally nobody that can get up there, but he's in a good position and he's just pushing the wave out.
Yeah, his team was winning teleported down and they picked up a couple of kills, solidifying his tiny lead in the top lane. Has the home guards and the Triforce completed? It's another power spike. So Gambit, they're hitting power spikes left, right, and center, and they need to translate this into an advantage. Will SK fight this dragon? I wouldn't. It was SK when it comes up again. But they almost have to.
Something else I also want to highlight here, Crepo. Both Cabochard and Betsy have upgraded their trinkets already to those greater stealth totems. Contrast to nobody on the side of SK. So all of that warding Gambit has been using has worked off, worked out rather. They've had pretty good information to play with. And it looks like they're going to have the tools to keep that up. As it looks like Freddy's going towards a Blade of the Rune King, potentially as his first item.
Now, where is Forgiven going to go? Candy Panda taking his time with pushing out the bot lane. This frees up the 80 carry resource for Gambit. And Corki's really good in these poke siege situations in the early to mid game because his rocket poke is paramount to getting that advantage, getting that zone control to push people off the tower, get another objective, translate that into deep vision, plan ahead. What's your next step? Always look ahead. And Candy Panda is almost like freezing the bot lane, slowly pushing it out. Now has to base. Doesn't want to base because he wants to push out that lane and.
Well, this happened to Candy Panda yesterday against H2K, and that just allowed H2K to engage on SK whenever there was a numbers disadvantage. You can see, look at the wards.
But are they going to use it?
That's the question.
Step one is getting the vision. Step two is using it. So are we going to see a mid-push rotation top, poke in the mid lane? What's Candy going to do here?
It looks to be mid-push rotation top, as you've predicted, Crepo. Freddy's going to be in trouble.
He wants to clear the wave. That's his main job right now, clean that wave.
Well, he's got a centaur to deal with it. He's putting a lot of damage down onto Cabochard. The rest of Gambit have responded. So Freddy's going to be careful. Eats a phosphorus bomb, but look at the minion wave. It's now starting to conga line in. Gambit, they've got good wave clear. And SK, all of it's pretty low range. They've got to be careful if Gabba commits to this.
Yeah, they missed their timing. They didn't stack any waves, so double barrel and some damage from Fox clears it out. And Gambit is posturing for a dive, but the next wave is still 15 seconds out. He sent down Cabochard to the bot lane. He's swapping it up. Yeah, they need to hit multiple pressure points and then start rotating. Bot to mid, top, top back to mid, and eventually group up with Cabochard. If they play their cards right, I can see Gambit getting the tier 2 tower on bottom, actually. Just keep SK locked in here and then move away eventually. Just don't drop any casualties along the way.
Keep your eyes on that mini-map. Cabochard is pushing out that bottom wave. Forgiven is pushing in the middle wave. Betsy with the help of Ghost Super Pepper top. So this is an assault on all fronts on behalf of SK. And they seem to be clearing the waves for the time being. But you can see Cabo's now left bottom as Freddy came to meet him.
5,000 gold lead still for Gambit. Makes you wonder how would they do this if they didn't have this advantage. They're slowly chipping away at the towers. We're going in!
Wow, we see that's Diamond. He's caught out. Diamond's down. Enraged flashed for that one. I can only assume for the headbutt pulverize. Kill credit to Candy Panda.
And this stops the bleeding. This slows the game down yet again. And Gambit caught in rotation. Svenskeren down, or Freddy down in the bottom lane right now. He's going to push that out. They held down. Fox managed to chunk out for giving enough to stop him from hitting the towers. No extra tower went down. It's too early for Baron Bates. However, Gambit have two dragons. We're a minute and 40 seconds away from the third, and we could see a potential explosive fight right there because that gives you extra movement speed and that facilitates those rotations, those map-wide plays. And meanwhile, Candy Panda is still only on that BT. Look how long it takes for him to finish that Krug.
Luckily, sitting on 1,000 gold, so should be able to pick up a little bit more attack speed on this rotation. We did see the Blade of the Rune King picked up for Freddy and some Giant's Belts on the side of SK. But truthfully, still 4,000 gold down at the 20-minute mark. And SK looking for a advantageous position. Diamond's going to run into the jungle, find Freddy out. So Dragon in a minute. You can see Cabo's pushed the wave out. He's got Teleport to play with.
And they want to steal this Red Bull. That's what you want to do. You want to deny resources to your opponent. If you can't get the towers, take their jungle. Slowly make them bleed gold. Freddy's getting poked.
Well, red buff is still up there. It looks like it was secured by Diamond and the smite. Freddy's gonna...
Knock
Dragon's
up.
Descent, but the knockup comes up from Diamond. He manages to find him, and Betsy gets a kill credit. There's the onslaught of Shadows. Throws in Rated back into the waiting arms of Ghost Super Pepper. But Candy says, come and hug me. Pulls him out with Fate's Call. And SK turn around. It doesn't look like we're done just yet. SK are one man down, but here comes Diamond once again. He flashes in, and he takes down the Minotaur. We see the Hemo Plague sucking out the blood from Diamond Prox as Gambit now back away. Initially, Gambit get the kill, but they trade one for one in the follow-up fights.
Again, miscommunication by SK. Freddy's trying to defend that red buff without smite of his own. He has to yield eventually, dies to the double knockup threat from Rek'Sai Lu. Svenskeren here for a bit too deep, has to flash. And as well, Enraged and Candy Panda still not in sync. Unbreakable Will and Fate's Call used. Double disengage tools, you have to spread them out. You can't use them at the same time.
So this time round, ends up costing them some control in the mid lane. Gambit burned a lot of cooldowns. There's a wave pushing towards them, but it looks like they've started this dragon off. Here's a replay of that fight.
Freddy wants to stop that. He's gonna get interrupted if it's not by Diamond Prox popping up. It might be by Betsy just hexing him, slowing him, knocking him up. And Rated pops Unbreakable Will, and then gets Fates Called out. But meanwhile, another bout.
So, Dragon was not secured.
Not yet.
Look at the cooldown timers on the left and right of your screen. Hemo Plague not up for Vladimir, nor Unbreakable Will for Enraged, but it's close. Gambit, on the other hand, they're only missing the Radiance from Taric, and Cabochard should have Onslaught soon. It's ticking away. Dragon down to 3,000 hit points. Unbreakable Will used quite early, I feel, from Enraged. Gambit do not actually commit.
Look at the top wave. Look at the mid lane as well. Gambit in full control right here.
Looks like SK have opted not to take this fight. They have backed away. Gambit looking for a fight. Onslaught of Shadows could be used
if
Cabochard wanted to.
Just go mid and take that tower.
Decided against it. Well, I'll take that back. They have pushed down. Look at the top lane. Minions doing work. Gambit's champions doing work in the middle lane. And Dragon still unsecured, so they could peel back for that one.
Fantastic map-wide play by Gambit right here. Pepper with the Dazzle.
Explosive cast knocks Gosu Pepper into the waiting hands of Fox. We see Svenskeren is going to be running amok as he's found Diamond Procs. All of a sudden, Gambit, they are the ones that get a little split up. So they've lost two champions for securing two towers and potentially the dragon.
Gambit had a lot of options there, and they seem to want to take them all at once. Part of the team went top lane. Pepper split down to the bottom. He got caught by Fox. There wasn't enough backup. Top tower was already falling, and at two dragons on the mark, having those minion waves pushing into mid lane and top lane, I felt like Gambit should have moved for the middle lane and peel back together as a team for the dragon. They failed to do so. Give SK some breathing room, but the gold lead, still 5.5k.
Is this actually happening? There's no vision here from SK. Look at the vision. You can see in red, it's moving toward it up.
Rek'Sai Scream usually prompts that Baron start.
Ward goes down. SK are now aware of it. The Gambit, they've not peeled off this crap, but it's going very, very slowly. Look at the minimap, guys. Tower secured in favor of SK. Freddy has been caught out. He's been knocked up, and Cabochon is rampaging all over Freddy's face. Forgiven's valked over the wall and flashed rather. Inrated's going to get eventually cut down where he stands once Unbreakable wears off. Baron was prevented. The Gambit get a few more kills onto their belt.
Yeah, and Gambit speeding up this game now. Another two kills. And this is, well, while you might hesitate with a gold lead to get those tier 2 towers, that can be rough. Eventually, if you keep that style on and you keep deep warding, Baron Bay becomes an extra variable that SK will have to deal with, and they don't have the resources to, you know, to cover all these holes. Their boat is sinking, and they had a couple of fingers they could place in every hole to stop the water from flowing in, but now another hole appeared in the form of that Baron, and we're going down.
Never heard of that before. The rift being referred to as
it's a flooding.
It's flooding
with the tears of SK Gaming. And they try and catch on. 6,000 gold lead now for Gambit.
Down four towers, down a dragon, down a kill. Again, warding from Gambit is good. You could probably put an argument forward for maybe over-warding. I can't believe I'm actually using those words, but look at the vision. Almost every time you look down, Gambit have got between 5 and 6 wards in SK's jungle, which is fantastic. It's allowing them control.
I don't think it's necessarily over-warding. I just think it's not using them efficiently, and it's very easy for us to spot that sitting here. I mean, many critics have said the same things for when I was playing, like, you have those wards, why aren't you using them? Because it's hard, because there's so much chaos. It's hard to communicate as a team. Gambit shot calling yesterday looked very meek. But right now, it's a lot better. They have the right ideas. Eventually, I'll pronounce that word right.
Well, we'll get there eventually, Crepo. But take a look at the items really quickly. Deathcap was picked up for Betsy. Fox got a needlessly large rod and Negatron. Frozen Heart for Cabochard. Blade of the Ruined King for Forgiven. So a few big item spikes. I like the fact that Diamond's also got that locket. Help prevent some of the burst from Fox's Vlad.
All right, crucial point in the game. They denied the vision around the Baron. They're going to push in mid lane one more time. Fight or peel back for a Baron bait?
Let's find out. Freddy's got full rage bar. He's going to be able to engage if he wants to. Cabochard holds on to the Onslaught of Shadows. He's been doing that all game long, and they've got the Unbreakable Will once more. Inrated very quick on the trigger finger. The last 2 or 3 times we've seen that being used, and Gambit peel away.
Gambit do have Darkness on their side. They decide not to bait. They leave Forgiving in the mid lane to distract their opponents, but Cabochard in the bot lane, I feel it's too much. Gambit again, they want too much at once. They can't punish the face because they were doing Baron. They have one member in the bot lane, they have one member in the mid lane. Decide what you want to do. You can do a 4-man Baron and have one guy pushing the mid lane, but then you need deeper vision. You need to make SK scared of face-checking every rush in a row. However, it's still the right idea. They're on the right track, and eventually, I screw up that word yet again as you gaze upon it. Stop looking at me like that. I can't help it.
I was trying to do it subtly. Take a look at your picture-in-picture, bottom left. Cabochard is teleporting in. He's in the tri-bush up north. Freddy has equaled that by coming in. Diamond Prox has found the knock-up onto Freddy. Candy Panda a little bit split up from the team as SKR landed in the river. The ship is sinking, and we see Fate's Call. It's going to pull in Rated backwards. He's got no Unbreakable Will. We do see Fox, the Hemoplague has popped, but Freddy is continuing to take damage. He may be going down. Not yet, though, as the face of the Mountain Shield will keep him up. Diamond and Forgiven looking to run SK down. Svenskeren now follows suit with Inrated into the death chamber. And after a drawn-out bout, Gambit find two and go back to Baron.
So much chaos in these fights, but Gambit is simply too tanky. None of their members fall down, and eventually SK will have to yield. Unbreakable Will wasn't up in that fight, so Enraided had to sacrifice himself for his team. Svenskun's down, no more smite. Should be a Baron pickup, and this should snowball the game. This should facilitate those things that Gambit was trying earlier. Now it'd be a lot easier because you have a lot of buddies with you in sense of buffed up minions.
Just shy of 10,000 gold in the lead. First Baron picked up here today for Gambit. You see, leading up to last week, on the graphic, a lot earlier than beforehand. But that was about the third or the fourth attempt that Gambit really felt they needed. The sort of rotational push backfired. And they set their sights on Baron. Look at those CS advantages again. Top lane, Cavoshot. Not only has he got the global objectives on his side, but a bunch of CS. And that's mirrored by Forgiven versus Candy Gambit.
Yeah, this has to feel good for the Gambit members. Down in the standings, issues adapting to the new split, but looking to get another win on the board. And SK, they came out in their press conference and they said, we need time to adapt. We need time to fix, go back to our old play style. But is it old or is it just too antique at this point? And can they play it well enough? Because they're looking 0-6 right now.
That's the way it's looking. Gambit, if they close this game out, they will be on a two-game winning streak from the week. From week three, rather. And of course, when you're one-third of the way through the split, it's a very, very big mountain to climb from 0-6. But Gambit still have to knock down the Nexus. It took
them a while.
A while yesterday. However, they do have a significantly more impressive lead today. They also have Baron, and you can see Cabo's pushing top, the rest of Gambit pushing bottom.
Now let's take a step back and see how did Gambit get into this position. Usually, we see Diamond Prox aiding Cabochard to get him fed, and that was a strategy. Then we wondered, is Diamond Prox going to assist Forgiven? Wasn't a question either. He just helped Betsy get pressure in the mid lane. They kept Fox down. Fox even said in those interviews, I don't have enough pressure. I feel I can't influence the game anymore. And Gambit preyed upon that Fox. Pressured him in. And then translated that with some rotations. Yes, they got caught a couple of times, but they had good IDs. They were taking one or two steps ahead of the curve and definitely outsmarting SK.
Take a look at this Baron buff, Crepper. They've already taken the inner turret on the bottom lane. They put pressure on the inhibitor turret as we hit 30 minutes. And Gambit are just using the buff very appropriately. Again, the minimap is littered with vision.
They have to get an inhibitor, though. That's what you want. The Baron buff at this point in the game with this big of a gold lead, you need to get something out of it. More than just some tier 2 towers.
I'm really not convinced by the Shyvana from Freddy yet. It was a second rotation picked with the Kalista. And we've not really seen it do a whole lot. Yes, SK have fallen behind from an early stage, so that limits the aggressive potential that Freddy can put on the map. But he's just being pushed around by Cabochard. Really not having an impact. Fox!
Dazzle forces the pool.
Who's gonna go down with
that? That's the tower. This is the opening Gambit wants.
So let's see if Gambit can get out cleanly. Doesn't seem to be an engage yet from SK. Sanguine pool 3 seconds before it's available. Diamond and Forgiven putting some auto attacks onto the inhibitor. It's going low. It will take a few more hits. Svenskeren's gone in with a body slam, but doesn't manage to throw down the cask. Onslaught of Shadows comes out, and Sven's down before he can even ultimate. Inhibitor will drop. And SK with really disconnected defense lose their base inhibitor.
Yeah, very often you see a team make a panic play here to defend that inhibitor, a Hail Mary, if I may. But SK, a couple of their members wanted to go in and the rest wasn't really in sync. As you say, disconnected, and you can't afford to be disconnected as a team at this point in the split. If you have any hopes to make it to playoffs.
Definition of effective use of Baron buff. Multiple towers, kills, and they've cracked open the base. It's going to allow Gambit an uncontested third dragon.
Full Khaleesi.
And this is entirely up to Gambit to close this game out now. It can spend some of that money. If we look at the gold, you can see everybody's around 1,000, 1,500, 2,000 gold to spend. So everybody's going to come back with these big power spikes, as you'll see those pickups. Randians for Diamond, a BF Sword for Cabochard. Last Whisper for Forgiven. And SK will be asking for forgiveness for kicking Forgiven.
And you talk about all these items, but you forget the most important one, Face of the Mountain. on our Gem Knight, Taric. Goes to Pepper, 0-3 and 10 right now.
What do you think of the Taric so far? I mean, in the context of how the game has played out, the Dazzle, locked down a few targets, set up a few plays.
I will hold my judgment.
That's fair.
I will see if this Taric becomes a staple meta pick. Back from the shadows where he's lurking, sharpening his diamonds.
I want to quote that, something Enrated actually said from the press conference yesterday. One of the questions was related to if Enrated will pull out some fun picks like he did in the Spring Split. And Enrated's response was that until, you know, the basics and the foundations are locked down, he feels he'd rather stick to the traditional picks. Obviously, Gosu Pepe went against that theory today, and Freddy and Fox, they've been looking for some different champions. They've been struggling to adapt, even Sven Skeren in some ways.
Now, it's always a question. Are people picking different picks out of creativity or out of necessity? Are they limited in their champions pool to the point where they have to pick off-meta picks that are technically inferior? Or are they actually trying to curveball? We've seen the unicorns throw out those off-meta picks, often to their advantage, but...
Even then, it wasn't a big deal. I think in week one or week two, the top lane Nocturne. We do see Diamond, he's got knocked backwards. Sven Skeren calling out Mary once more, and Diamond just laughs it off.
Yeah, but Cabochard is doing a blue buff on the bottom, so they have to hold their horses here and wait for the cavalry to arrive. Just don't use too much of your ammunition on that top tower. Just wait for Cabochard to get to the bot lane. Effectively split pushing. You can wait 30 more seconds. You waited 34 minutes, Gambit. You can wait a little longer. Betsy jukes it, but Forgiven goes in.
Wow, there's the Wild Growth already onto Forgiven. Sven Skeren dashes forward with Dragon's Descent and a Valkyrie away. We'll put that cosplay equalizer down on the ground. Now Gosu Pepper's running, but look at Cabochard. He's going to grab another inhibitor, and if it's at the cost of Gosu Pepper's life, that is a fair trade any day of the week. Super minions will now be pouring through the bottom lane as SK's engaged nets them a kill. Now Cabochard a little bit in trouble.
Gosu Pepper, the hero Gambit needed and deserved. He trades his life willingly for a bot lane inhib here and a Forgiven. He wants some blood. Kills his ex-teammate. Wants another one.
Fox flashed forward for that one as Cabochard cleans up Enrated. Still a little while before that inhib spawns, but now with two members down, Gambit on the top lane.
One inhib, two inhibs. Gambit, they want their third.
They should be able to grab this one. SK not doing a whole lot. Onslaught of Shadows goes, I think, a little wide of Candy Panda, but Cabochard is just rampaging through. He 1v1s Candy Panda like a hot knife through butter. Freddy tries to fly away, but those wings don't have anything under them. And Freddy goes down for the fifth time. The third inhibitor falls. Gambit set their sights on the Nexus turret, and they want to go 2-0 in week 3. 8-1-5. For Cabochard. Man, that started it all off. Gambit undefeated. SK 0-6. Convincing victory from Gambit.
Quick, clean, polished. I was talking about Taric. Oh yeah, and a victory for Gambit was nice too. Nah, it looked all right. I'm not quite sold on the Taric pick just yet, but I think it did what it had to do. It kept Candy Panda down. Traditionally the best performing member on the SK Gaming roster so far. And he was down 30 CS against Forgiven and Edward here in the bottom lane. So they did what it had to do. Forgiven died a lot so far in this split, but zero deaths against this old SK.
Very well played. Most damage dealt in the game. And I feel a little bad, but I do feel I have to call this one out. During the course of this game again, Candy Panda dealt less damage than his jungler. Sven Skeren's Gragas dealt more damage to champions by about 600. Vladimir, Shyvana both dealt more damage. It feels like Candy Panda's being shut out. Yesterday, it was Twisted Fate Annie. Today, it was Taric Hecarim. Yes, there is focus on him. We have to always keep that in mind. But not finding success with their new old AD carry.
Yeah, there's a vast difference with playing Kalista from ahead, like Free showed us, and the Kalista from behind. It's really hard to do so, but what worries me more is these little instances of just miscommunications, disconnection in the SK lineup. And if go to the other side, remember they lost Forgiven. Two victories right now, both on Corki.
Corki, go figure.
Go back in time. Say you're in Spring Split, around in the middle. just a little farther just to say week six and you're going, yes, next split, Forgiven will play for Gambit. All right, maybe, I can believe it. And he will go on a winning streak, okay, with Corki.
Yep, and using Corki against SK, a team that he did not play it with. So that wraps up the game, an undefeated week for Gambit, and for a closer look at their second summer.